Spellbound was a 1945 Alfred Hitchcock thriller featuring Ingrid Bergman, Gregory Peck, and psychoanalysis and dream interpretation. And of course, a brilliant Hitchcock story. We never completely know what's going on. And I'm going to say at the beginning, too, probably one of my biggest takeaways from watching this film was that brilliant musical score by Miklos Rozsas. It's amazing, but more on that later. As far as the actual film story goes, you know, from the beginning, this reminded me a lot of other Hitchcock films, where there's basically the formula of the beautiful young woman who falls for a guy with a mysterious past. You know, there's elements of the film Rebecca and Notorious that came to mind here. So the film opens up with Ingrid Bergman. Her character plays this psychoanalyst, Dr. Constance Petersen. She's working at a mental hospital in Vermont. We are introduced to her character, who is perhaps a little bit cold and analytical at the beginning of the film as she listens to the ravings of one of her patients. Now, the story here is that the head of the institution is stepping down and soon enough is going to be replaced by someone else, who will be this young Dr. Edwards, played here by Gregory Peck. So he shows up for dinner with the doctors and joins him at the table, and Dr. Constance, of course, seems instantly taken with him. And you know, Gregory Peck's awesome to me. I think he's a great actor, and in these older films, he's just this lanky, skinny guy who kind of has this young Abraham Lincoln vibe to him. But anyhow, the first clue that something might be a little odd here is that, you know, during the course of the meal, Dr. Constance is explaining something about, like, the oblong shape of a swimming pool, and she casually draws a circular shape with a fork on the table. And for some reason, Dr. Edwards sees this and starts, like, freaking out and getting all agitated. And some eerie music kicks in as well. Okay, but he recovers quickly. Nothing to see here. Nothing weird at all. So it's the next day, and Dr. Edwards, he complains about having a headache and asks Dr. Petersen if she'd like to go for a walk in the country. And their mutual romantic interest starts to grow, of course. And later that evening, Dr. Petersen can't sleep, and she goes for a romantic visit to meet with Dr. Edwards. They embrace, and they obviously are in love with each other. But wouldn't you know it, the pattern of lines that appears on her robe starts to freak him out. He's got something about lines that just triggers him. So we eventually figure out that this Edwards character is not just an imposter, but that apparently he has amnesia and doesn't really know who he is. And to be honest, the amnesia gimmick always sort of gets me, mainly because I grew up on a steady diet of 80s TV shows, and I'm always a little reluctant to buy into the amnesia storyline as an overused ploy from shows like MacGyver. But it's okay. We'll roll with it here and see where it goes. So he tells Dr. Constance that the only clue of his real identity is that he has a cigarette lighter with the initials JB. Whatever could it mean? So she tells him that she believes him and will help solve the mystery. So he leaves to get some sleep, but during the night he slips her a note saying that he's going to leave, he's in love with her, and he's going to head off to the Empire State Hotel in New York. And sure enough, some police investigators show up the next day to question Dr. Constance, and in typical Hitchcock style, they step into her room and they step all over the letter that he has left on the floor for her, but they don't notice it. After they leave, she does notice the letter, picks it up, reads it, and then goes after him. So Dr. Constance shows up at the hotel in New York. She's trying to find Dr. Edwards. And I like that at this point, the actor Wallace Shawn comes in and sits next to her. He was in those Mummy films. He was kind of the goofy sidekick. Unfortunately, he's a lecherous creep here, but hotel security shoos him off and then is very helpful in helping her find where this Dr. Edwards is staying. And they're reunited, and clearly she's fallen in love with him. Now, he at this point thinks he may have actually killed the real-life Dr. Edwards and, like, stolen his identity. We, the audience, still don't quite know what's going on. And the film at this point becomes something of a couple-on-the-run movie, with newspapers reporting that there's this manhunt going on for him, and they're just trying to stay out of the public eye and go into hiding. So they take a train to the house of Dr. Alex Brulov, who was played here awesomely by Michael Chekhov, who was Dr. Peterson's teacher and mentor, who is more than happy to give her a place to stay. When they arrive, he's not home yet, but two cops are waiting there, waiting to question this doctor. Now, they, of course, don't know who Dr. Constance and Dr. Edwards are, so there's a little brief bit of awkward tension, Hitchcock style. Do these police know who these two are? But Dr. Brulov eventually arrives home, shoos off the cops. Dr. Brulov is exactly what you'd expect from the stereotype Freudian psychoanalyst. You know, he's got the beard, the Germanic accent, and all that stuff. And he offers them a place to stay at his place and gives them a room. But look, it's 1945, so don't worry. There's no hanky-panky or anything. So during the night, Edwards goes off to the washroom, and realizing he needs a shave, he gets out a straight razor. Now, something in the bathroom triggers him. I didn't quite follow. I think it was just everything that's white in the bathroom, maybe like soap, the tub, the sink. And he goes into this weird trance state and sleepwalks downstairs with the razor still open in his hand, and he finds the doctor awake. And it's pretty creepy, actually. But this Dr. Brulov character seems unfazed, and he prattles on about not being able to sleep and how he has to have milk and crackers and so on. And he notices the razor and then offers Edwards some milk, apparently laced with a ton of sedatives, and knocks the poor guy out. So the next day, this Dr. Constance and Dr. Brulov, they're talking about the situation, and they try to do some deep therapy, including some dream interpretation. And this part of the film gets kind of cool. As Edwards is describing his dreams, we see these bizarre and awesome visuals that were designed by artist Salvador Dali. And it's really cool. It's like seeing an animated version of a Dali painting. You know, stuff like weird eyeballs and creepy melting things. And from this, they figure out that there's some sort of childhood trauma that took place. And they tie it somehow to skiing. So then the next thing is that Dr. Edwards and Dr. Constance, they decide to take a trip to the place Gabriel Valley for a skiing trip to see if that'll maybe jog some of his memories. And what follows is an extremely fake-looking skiing segment. I'm just being honest, but, you know, whatever. As they're skiing, right when they get to the point they're about to veer off a cliff, it all comes back to Edwards, and he begins to remember the source of his trauma. Now, I don't want to say too much at this point, because I don't want to just reveal the whole movie, but I like kind of building up to what happens at the end. It's really a great ending. I'll leave you to figure out if he can figure it out. Can he snap out of these weird episodes? Will the police catch up with him? I'm not going to spoil it, only to say that this is a classic Hitchcock ending. And even though it was a black and white movie, you got to watch close because there's a very brief inclusion of the color red near the end of the film. I'm not going to say much more about it, but it's an amazing Hitchcock conclusion. And just some quick closing thoughts. You got to go check this one out. One of the things that really stuck with me from this film is the music of Miklos Rozsas, which is just amazing. It's a beautiful, very memorable leitmotif that you hear throughout the film. It's varied during the course of the movie, but it just sticks with you. It's gorgeous music. And it's actually one of the scores that I have heard inspired movie composer Jerry Goldsmith, who's one of my favorites. I would share some of the music in this video, but every time I do stuff like that, pesky old YouTube will slap me with a copyright claim. So I'll just put a link in the comments below. Go check this out. Ingrid Bergman is amazing as usual. Loved her character in this movie. And I will admit, it can be a challenge for me personally not to see her as Elsa from Casablanca. But she's great here. And she's a very sympathetic love interest to Gregory Peck's character. And again, when I see Gregory Peck, I always think young Abraham Lincoln. But his tortured character is very believable. You really want to figure out what's going on. Who is he? Does he really have this amnesia? What's the full story? And I also like the goofy old Dr. Brulov character, you know, prattling on about his milk and crackers. He was a fun addition to this movie in helping solve the mystery. That's Spellbound from 1945. It's an excellent, suspenseful Hitchcock movie. It's worth checking out.